Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Leading with Care in a Tough World, Beyond Servant Leadership, by Bob DeKoch and Phillip G. Clampitt. Narrated by Carolyn Jania. Preface. Type the words leadership book into Amazon.com and you'll find over 60,000 titles. That's good news because it means that many people aspire to be better leaders. The bad news? You can't read them all. Leading with Care in a Tough World differs from other books because we explain how recalibrating five core leadership beliefs, uncertainty, progress, values, learning, and caring, can transform your daily leadership behaviors in ways that will fulfill your career aspirations and propel your organization to new levels. The first section of the book helps leaders grapple with some fundamental questions. How should you react to the inherent uncertainties of life? How do you define progress? What core values should guide your relationships, aspirations, and decisions? How do people learn and unlearn? How can you be kind in a tough world? All leaders, regardless of experience level, could enhance their viewpoints on these questions. This book provides the framework for wisely responding to these fundamental questions. Answers to these questions serve as a springboard to the second section of the book, which highlights specific visible and subtle practices of inspiring leaders. In this section, we discuss issues such as coaching employees, communicating effectively, collaborating with others, establishing value-adding relationships, and managing pushback. Other leadership books may deal with some of these issues, but few connect these issues to core leadership beliefs in the way Leading with Care in a Tough World does in terms of depth, insight, and practicality. We sought to go beyond the rich foundation of the servant leadership movement. Specifically, Leading with Care goes beyond a string of stories from accomplished executives. To be sure, much can be learned from leaders like Steve Jobs, Meg Whitman, Winston Churchill, Indra Nooyi, and others. Leadership books of this type often illuminate and may inspire readers. Yet these books often neglect to discuss the practical, strategic insights leaders need to use on a daily basis to achieve amazing outcomes. We tell our fair share of illuminating stories, but we also drill down into the specifics of the lessons learned and how to implement the lessons in the workplace. Note, in some cases, we used aliases and changed small details to protect the leader's identity. Leading with Care highlights both the development of the leader's mindset and the leader's relationships with others. Many books devoted to the softer leadership side tend to focus on me, that is, development of the leader's personal emotional control and empathy. That's important, but only part of the equation. The missing piece of the equation involves developing the proper we, the cultivating of proper relationships between leaders and others. Part 1 of Leading with Care highlights the core beliefs and thinking routines leaders need to develop themselves, the me. Part 2 builds on this foundation and educates listeners on how to cultivate the proper relationships, the we, to create extraordinary outcomes. If you wade through all the leadership books, you would be unlikely to find any other work that skillfully integrates these two sides of the leadership equation. Leading with Care presents leadership principles that were tested, tried, and refined over decades of practice. Some leadership books tout trailblazing research. Others advocate ideas based on extraordinary personal experiences. Both approaches have merit. Leading with Care is based on both original research and professional experience. Yet, we take it one step further. We've tested these practices and refined them based on the experiences and feedback of others. The approach we take in this book allows us to answer some of the most tough and vexing challenges leaders face today, including 1. How can leaders better respond to the great uncertainties of the day and make progress? 2. How do leaders translate admirable leadership ideas into everyday practices? 3. How can leaders transform pushback into a unifying consensus? 4. Why isn't emotional intelligence enough to succeed as a leader today? 5. How do caring leaders encourage others while avoiding toxic positivity? 6. Why do leaders need to adjust their leadership approach in a post-COVID world? 7. How do leaders transform the sentiments of servant leadership into tangible actions that produce extraordinary results? 8. How should caring leaders respond to political activism by employees? 9. How do caring leaders embrace diversity and inclusiveness to cultivate high-performance cultures? Answers to these questions and many more emerge next. Enjoy, learn, explore. Introduction. If you have ever received a package in the mail emblazoned with a "handle with care" label, what would you expect to see inside? Something fragile, no doubt. And perhaps something quite valuable. Your anticipation grows as you carefully unwrap the package and wonder about what might be hidden deep in the bubble wrap or buried in the shredded paper. After you solve that mystery, what happens next? You look for damage or if something is broken or missing. You wonder if, in fact, the package was handled with care. Treating people, e.g. employees, colleagues, customers, and stakeholders, like they have handle with care tags affixed to their t-shirts, smocks, hoodies, sweaters, or lapels should be built into every leader's DNA. Likewise, treating the pursuit of outcomes like they were wrapped with fragile handle with care tape should be a fundamental dimension of every leader's passion. This norm suggests an important question. What does handle with care actually mean to those in leadership positions? To many people, caring simply means expressing empathy, compassion, or concern. Fair enough. But we think it means much more. Caring at a deeper level acknowledges the unique circumstances people face. Think of it this way. People, like packages, endure lots of jostling and bumping as they move through life. Likewise, well-developed plans get challenged and torpedoed, sometimes every step of the way. Shallow caring rarely produces magical outcomes. Amazon would never have become a Fortune 50 company if it merely shipped packages with best wishes for a safe arrival. Rather, Amazon thinks more deeply about how to properly care for parcels. For instance, the packaging in the box protects the cargo, but so does the box's structure and the way the item gets packed. Using the right packing material, visible, is important. But it must be arranged in the right way, subtle. Amazingly, Amazon has now reinvented package delivery with Amazon Prime service to underpin the importance of deep caring in delivery. Likewise, we think of caring leadership as composed of visible and subtle elements. You might fool some people with shallow caring, but you can't lead them to extraordinary results by nodding concern and hoping for the best. You wouldn't treat a valuable package that way. So why would anyone lead in that way? Sadly, many in leadership positions do exactly that. Deep caring goes beyond short-term well wishes. We champion deep caring leadership that focuses on long-term, proactive, and developmental relationships. The contrast between shallow and deep caring may not be immediately evident to people. Yet over time, deep caring leadership supercharges people and their organizations, while unleashing latent energy on skills few could imagine. It never ceases to amaze us what people will accomplish when they know leaders commit their time to develop them, have their back, sincerely recognize and appreciate their contributions, display a genuine interest in them, lead with a sense of warmth and empathy, take time to listen to employees and make sure they feel heard, encourage them to do their best work, provide space for them to grow. In this tough, competitive, and high expectations world, many leaders don't behave in ways that generate these instinctive feelings. Yet when people sense these passions about their leaders, it magically awakens a visceral spirit of connection that engages people in wonderful ways. The passions, commitments, and sheer grit released by a caring leader springboards people to unseen and unparalleled heights. Degrees of caring. Shallow caring. Short-term. Appeasement-focused. Excuse-enabling. Comforting mindset. Empathy-motivated. Visible. Reactive. Placating. Deep caring. Long-term. Development-focused. Change-enabling. Transformational mindset. Solution-motivated. Visible and subtle, proactive, empowering. Why do we need to lead with care? Our businesses, our organizations, our governments, and our people are riddled with divisiveness. Consider five of the top concerns leaders across generations must address. Concern number one, employees lack engagement in their workplace. Gallup reported that only 15% of employees in the United States are truly engaged in the workplace. Yet nearly 70% of employees say they would work harder if they felt more appreciated. Over 90% of the employees surveyed believed their leadership lacks communication skills to lead. Another recent study estimated that low employee engagement costs U.S. companies $450 to $550 billion annually. We believe that estimate is too low. Concern number two, citizens lack trust in public sector leaders. Public sector leaders recognize that trust in their leadership is approaching historic lows. Citizens are resisting their public health advice. Pushback regarding the direction of public school instruction makes daily headlines. The lack of trust emerges, in part, from poor leadership skills by those who govern. Many political leaders are pushing people apart rather than pulling people together. Concern number three. The workplace in a post-COVID world will be reimagined. Work flexibility offered by remote work is considered a perk by many. In fact, 54% of office workers say they'd leave for a job with more flexibility. Envisioning an empowered workplace with a mix of on-site and remote workers represents an unprecedented leadership challenge. Concern number four, heightened political activism by employees has paralyzed many leaders. High-profile political protests represent sentiments that percolate throughout many organizations. Vocal employees often demand action by their leaders on their political issues, even as other employees directly or indirectly push back. Navigating these tricky waters requires a different and non-traditional leadership approach. Concern number five. The sentiments behind servant leadership and emotional intelligence have proven to be a daunting challenge. A virtual flood of books, seminars, and podcasts about servant leadership and emotional intelligence cultivated some of the core sentiments advocated in leading with care. Yet, many leaders struggle with how to act on these ideas in a practical way. Leading with care directly addresses these concerns. It has broad, worldwide applications in both the public and private sectors. Leaders who practice this caring approach will bring about much-needed leadership change. It will unite people, allowing them to accomplish the amazing. Who should listen to this book, and who should not? We wrote this book for aspiring leaders, practicing leaders, and seasoned executives seeking ways to unlock the untapped potential of others, their teams, and their organizations. Aspiring leaders often have the right desires, but not the tools. If you are an aspiring leader, you will encounter an avalanche of leadership articles and books. By placing Leading with Care at the top of your reading stack, you can develop the fundamental sentiments of great leaders as you learn the specific practices to act on those sentiments. If you are a practicing leader, you may have hit a rough patch because you recognize that meeting the organization's expectations is not enough on a personal or professional level. You may be seeking something more and want to invest in others in ways that produce magical results. At the root of your challenge may be the need to better understand the subtle skills of a caring leader. These are the ones that few researchers and practitioners ever speak about. This book will help you discover and develop exactly those skills. If you are a seasoned executive, leader of leaders who wants to build a great place to work, you may be looking for a framework to inspire other leaders in your organization. Caring leadership can awaken deeper, more profound passions in people. Nothing inspires people more than seeing caring leaders in action every day. So, whom is this book not for? It's not for those who are mired in self-deception and unwilling to shift their perspective and do the hard work of deep caring. If you think you might fall into that category, then we would recommend reading Leadership and Self-Deception as your starting point. Why should you believe us? Some authors' credibility flows from years of successful practice. Check. Other authors' expertise emerges from novel research projects. Check. And a few leadership authors offer a new twist on the extensive writing in the field. Check. We offer all three. Successful practice. Collectively, we have over 6 decades of experience successfully leading organizations. Bob has held a number of leadership positions in a diverse set of high-profile businesses. In his previous role as president of the Bolt Company, he and the Bolt team transformed the company into a billion-dollar business with divisions all across the United States. This was accomplished totally through organic growth. Phil has been honored with multiple named and endowed professorships and has received numerous awards for his teaching and scholarship while acting as department head in communication and information science programs. Both of your authors have mentored and coached leaders in for-profit and nonprofit organizations. And yes, both of your authors have made mistakes. But we have used them as learning opportunities to refine our leadership approaches. We use these experiences to enrich the practices advocated in this book. Novel research. We have conducted numerous innovative studies about uncertainty management, communication satisfaction, progress making, organizational culture, clear thinking, safety practices, and employee empowerment, with thousands of employees across a wide range of organizations. We routinely monitor employee engagement in a variety of companies. For example, over a recent 6-year period at the Bolt Company, we found that 93% of over 4,000 respondents agreed that team members collaborate to solve problems. And the most frequent words used to describe their work environment were exciting, collaborative, and team. In another study, we found that 98% of employees believed the leadership team has responded appropriately to the COVID-19 virus, We used the insights from these various studies to formulate the sensibilities and key insights in this book. New twist. Our respective shelves are stacked with books on leadership and biographies of great leaders, accumulated over decades of readings and pondering the core practices of excellent leaders. The books range from scholarly tomes like Sensemaking in Organizations by Carl Weick, to more popular books like Emotional Intelligence by Daniel Goleman, to the softer but enlightening works like Who Moved My Cheese by Johnson and Blanchard. Before writing this book, we scrutinized the heavily earmarked and highlighted passages from the stacks of books and articles that line our personal libraries. We sought to distill the core insights into our unique perspective on caring leadership. We even revisited and refined ideas from our previous books. No doubt some listeners will recognize updates to that thinking in this book. In short, here's why you should carefully contemplate the ideas in this book. We've uniquely synthesized our collective expertise, novel research, and new twists on the leadership literature in order to provide you with actionable practices to enhance your leadership style. We don't claim to have all the answers, but we believe this book offers profoundly valuable perspective to aspiring leaders, practicing leaders, and leaders of leaders. Embrace a little uncertainty, listen on, and let's find out. What can you expect? Deep caring leadership emerges from five core beliefs. Embracing uncertainty promotes growth. Progress making inspires extraordinary performance. Cultivating the right values builds a special sense of identity. Lifelong learning fosters humility. Acting with kindness is not being soft. These fundamental beliefs are captured in Part 1, The Beliefs of Caring Leaders. Part 2 of the book builds on these core beliefs and highlights 9 key practices leaders need to master in order to deliver unexpected and remarkable outcomes. We start each chapter by defining the core practice and discussing why it is so important. Next, we share more specific techniques you should master in the quest to become a more caring leader. We divide these techniques into 2 categories: A, visible practices that people can easily observe, and B, subtle practices that are not clearly visible to many, but engage people on deeper levels. Parts 1 and 2 are symbiotically related. Strengthening one bolsters the other and vice versa. As your commitment deepens to these core beliefs, so will your ability to act on those beliefs. Likewise, as you use more of the caring leader practices, your beliefs that support those practices will intensify. Caring leaders embrace a deep, robust, and never-wavering commitment to their fellow human beings. Yet, sometimes caring leaders need to be tough to demonstrate that they care on a deeper level. In short, caring leaders are on a mission to inspire others to achieve even more extraordinary results than they ever dreamed possible for themselves and their organizations. So, let's get right to the hard work. It starts with re-examining your core beliefs about deep caring. Listen on, reflect further, and grow. Part 1. The Beliefs of Caring Leaders. This section spotlights 5 core beliefs that distinguish caring leaders from other types of leaders, enriching your understanding, appreciation, and commitment to these beliefs profoundly enhances your leadership potential. Collectively, these core beliefs of caring leaders can generate greater passion, performance, and results. It is better to know some of the questions than all of the answers. James Thurber. Chapter 1. Embracing uncertainty accelerates growth. With open arms and high expectations, administrators, professors, and staff welcomed the new chancellor, Dr. Faux to their mid-size university. His friendly smile, amiable manner, endearing and inspired quips, and occasional y'alls endeared him to many, at least for a while. Some grumblings about his leadership style emerged about 6 months later. Growing pains was the refrain for some time as people adjusted to his priorities, proclivities, and style. During the summer break, the misgivings about his leadership seemed to dissipate, much like the winter chill. As the fall semester progressed, the original concerns reemerged and became more acute. In November, Dr. Faux held a regularly scheduled brainstorming meeting with his direct reports. This was the first occasion when Dr. Faux invited some faculty members to expand the pool of ideas. Most of the faculty members were honored to be included and welcomed the opportunity. After Dr. Faux presented the problem to the group, he asked for ideas. The faculty, who were new to the group, waited for the direct reports to offer up the first comments. Crickets, not a chirp. Time seemed to tick down like the clock on the final round of Jeopardy. When the time was just about to expire, Dr. Faux queried, "What about the faculty members? Do you have any ideas?" One senior faculty member immediately heeded the opportunity. "What about ABC? Dr. Faux grimaced a bit and declared with his most charming accent, "That dog don't hunt. Any other ideas?" Another faculty member suggested another approach. Dr. Faux's response, "That dog don't hunt either, and here's why." Sensing the pattern, nobody else offered any ideas, even though Dr. Faux kept prodding the group for more input. His patience waned and he huffed, "Why do I have to do all the thinking around here?" And he disgustedly stomped out of the room. The answer, of course, was painfully clear to everyone around the table. Dr. Faux was the only one with good ideas. By routinely shooting down every suggestion, he had stifled all input. Dr. Faux's style vividly illustrates how someone, despite his queries, actually thinks he has all the answers. He demonstrates no tolerance for uncertainty because his analysis is always correct. He won't even explore the reasoning behind a suggestion that he disagrees with. At the most fundamental level, he leads by commanding others through his positional power, rather than caring about the people and the university in a meaningful way. What does it mean to embrace uncertainty? Uncertainty can best be defined by its opposite. Certainty means that something is fixed or settled. Every time we jump up, we come down. That's a certainty explained by the law of gravity. Ben Franklin's oft-quoted maxim cites two other certainties. "Our new constitution is now established. Everything seems to promise it will be durable, but in this world, nothing is certain except death and taxes." So, we think of death and taxes as certainties because they are absolutely predictable knowns, even though we just don't know when or how much. But Ben's quote also offers some frequently overlooked advice about uncertainty. The first clause of this legendary quip cautions the founders. They should not take for granted that the constitutional principles will endure over time. In other words, don't treat something that is inherently uncertain as if it is a certainty. Those who are certain are free of doubt. They are sure of what they know, just like Dr. Faux. Leaders who embrace uncertainty embrace doubt. They question what is fixed and settled. Are there places in the universe where people could jump up and never come down? Questions like this suggest an implicit tentativeness about our state of knowledge. Nothing is settled once and for all. Embracers of uncertainty hold even their most coveted knowledge as but a rough approximation. Physicist Richard Feynman described the impact of the theory of relativity in this way. "The first discovery is, essentially, that even those ideas which have been held for a very long time and which have been very accurately verified might be wrong." It was a shocking discovery, of course, that Newton's laws are wrong. after all those years in which they seemed to be accurate, we now have a much more humble point of view of our physical laws. Everything can be wrong. If a Nobel Prize-winning hard scientist operates with this kind of humility, then why shouldn't world-savvy leaders succeed by acknowledging what they don't know? Of course, there are degrees of uncertainty. This is not an either-or proposition. A continuum may be the best way to conceptualize uncertainty. Most people could mark a spot on the scale characterizing their level of certainty about the following statements. If a baseball player heaves a ball into the air, it will return to the ground. The sun will rise tomorrow. I'll have a job next year. On the next flip of the coin, it will land on heads. Elvis is dead. Even though embracing the unknown, the chaotic, the vague, and the random may not apply to all situations, it does dominate the mindset of caring leaders. Why? Because the situations that command leaders' attention are fraught with uncertainty, such as envisioning the future, wrestling with novel circumstances, managing complex systems, and anticipating human behavior. Embracing uncertainty means not only accepting but welcoming fluidity, lack of explicit control, unknown variables, and new ideas into your everyday life. Uncertainty continuum. Certainty. Known. Law-like. Sure. Clear. Predictable. Absolute. Simple. Stable. Uncertainty. Unknown. Chaotic. Unsure. Vague. Random. Provisional. Complex. Turbulent. Why do caring leaders embrace uncertainty? Embracing uncertainty serves as a foundational belief for caring leaders for three mutually reinforcing reasons. Important thing to do. If you are personally committed to deep caring, then embracing uncertainty could be viewed as one of your most important commitments. Why? Because caring leaders focus on the long-term development of others. If that's true, then leaders should allow others to learn, grow, and change in unexpected ways. Caring leaders let others surprise them. For instance, one professor requires on a weekly basis that his students take a quiz on the reading material and then write a commentary about how the ideas relate to the student's professional or personal life. For grading purposes, he is much more interested in the quality of the commentary than the grade on the quiz. In fact, even if students correctly answer all 10 quiz questions and write an acceptable commentary, they will earn 95 points. Why 95 and not 100 points? As one exasperated student expressed, "What do I need to do to get 100 points?" The professor calmly replied, "Share an insight. A novel way of looking at an issue, a fresh, original thought in some unexplored terrain. Continue to push yourself. Wow me. And more importantly, wow yourself. That's the 95 to 100 point range." And that's exactly what happened for this student and all the others listening to the exchange. This professor was embracing uncertainty in an educational world dominated by a checklist mentality. Right thing to do. Ethicists liberally use words like honesty, fairness, and truth in their writings. These concepts directly relate to embracing uncertainty. After all, if leaders honestly evaluated almost any situation, they would admit that some situational dimensions remain obscure or unknown. In essence, the truth is often emergent over time. Acknowledging those unknowns produces a more honest appraisal of it and fosters more flexibility as new facts emerge. Humility in the face of the unknown and unknowable represents a fundamental kind of honesty. Likewise, being fair to others requires caring leaders to acknowledge that there may be perspectives that have not been shared or issues not yet surfaced. We believe all caring relationships are rooted in a healthy tolerance for uncertainty. This ethical imperative emerges from a core belief that leaders can only partially envision the potential of others because so much remains unknown and perhaps unknowable. Embracing uncertainty celebrates the emergent potential of people who are discovering their own potential with the help of a caring leader. That sounds like the right thing to do. Smart thing to do. Several years ago, we wrote a book, Embracing Uncertainty, The Essence of Leadership. The book was based on some groundbreaking research involving over 1,000 employees working in organizations as varied as Fortune 100 companies, to small businesses, to educational institutions. We developed a series of questions to gauge the degree to which employees and organizations embrace uncertainty. 1. My organization is always on the lookout for new ideas to address problems. 2. My organization flexibly responds to different situations. 3. My organization easily spots changing trends. 4. My organization doesn't need a detailed plan when working on a project. 5. Even after my organization makes a decision, it will reevaluate the decision when the situation changes. 6. My organization needs to know the specific outcome before starting a project. These items are reverse scored. 7. My organization encourages employees to discuss their doubts about a project. 8. My organization actively looks for signs that the situation is changing. 9. My organization doesn't want employees to admit that they are unsure about something. These items are reverse scored. 10. My organization discourages employees from talking about misgivings. These items are reverse scored. The results of the study were revealing and somewhat surprising. We found that employees who worked in uncertainty-embracing organizations tended to be more satisfied with their jobs, more committed to their organizations, more likely to identify with their organizations, less cynical about organizational life. The surprise? It didn't matter if the employees personally embraced uncertainty in their daily work life. Even if they personally tended to value certainty over uncertainty, they wanted their organizations to embrace it. This makes sense. Consider an employee who works in a placid, routine organizational environment. Some employees may well enjoy their daily, stable routine, but they still recognize the ever-shifting, uncertain issues their organizations must deal with to stay relevant. Why don't leaders embrace uncertainty? So, let's assume that any or all of the stated reasons for embracing uncertainty resonate with a leader's sensibilities. Well, why don't they do it? We've discovered three typical reasons. Overconfidence. People often act with a certainty that only crumbles when the brute force of reality extracts its inevitable vengeance. Prior to World War II, the French generals defiantly insisted that the series of fortifications along the northeast border of France, the infamous Maginot Line, would protect the country from any Nazi attack. They were tragically mistaken. Perhaps if those in power had been a little less certain, the catastrophic and almost inexplicable human toll could have been diminished. But French generals were not alone. Many leaders suffer from overconfidence. Success is usually the culprit. At one time, Sears Roebuck was considered one of the best-managed companies in the world and one of the nation's most admired organizations. No longer. Osborne Computers, Schlitz Brewing, and Schwinn Bicycles, to name a few, have similar histories. In fact, the typical company has half the lifespan that people do. As one scholar concluded, there is something about the way decisions get made in successful organizations that sows the seeds of eventual failure. Good management was the most powerful reason they failed to stay atop their industries. Precisely because these firms listened to their customers, carefully studied market trends, and systematically allocated investment capital to innovations that promised the best returns, they lost their positions of leadership. The something? Overconfidence in established methodologies, markets, and modes of operation. Of course, companies need to listen to their customers, but not too closely. As Lee Iacocca once said, "No one ever told us to build a minivan." Of course, companies need to watch market trends, but not too carefully, because they can obscure new opportunities. Bottom line, the temptation to believe present success equals future success often proves too alluring, even when executives know better. Given this perspective, the philosophy of Andy Grove, the co-founder and chairman of Intel Corporation, that only the paranoid survive, makes a lot of sense. Paranoids embrace doubt. Most people don't. In fact, most people overestimate the accuracy of their judgment. In short, overconfidence leads to unrealistic expectations, overly aggressive goals, and a host of other miscalculations. Humility is not the opposite of confidence. It's the freedom for learning. Sally Grimes, CEO of Cliff Bar. Frustration. Personal anxiety often intensifies when trying to control the uncontrollable, predict the unpredictable, or know the unknowable. Everyone has been in situations where they felt compelled to provide an answer to questions to which they didn't know the answers. Perhaps they didn't want to look stupid, or perhaps they didn't want the boss to discover that they simply did not know. The result? An answer that provides temporary relief, but in the long term creates frustration, embarrassment, and sometimes regret. Consider the enormous pressure on law enforcement officials to produce a suspect when there is a serious crime. The grieving victim's family wants answers. Headline-seeking reporters demand answers as they thrust their microphones, recorders, and cameras in front of officials. Apprehensive citizens want action. It's tough to say we simply don't know yet. In fact, the pressure can be so intense that any suspect might do. After all, it creates certainty. The reporters go away, the public feels reassured, and the family starts the healing process. Unfortunately, the pressure can be so great that the wrong person is indicted. The public gets its certainty, but the officials must live with their doubts. In fact, officers of the court have been convicted for knowingly sending the wrong person to jail. That kind of false certainty should trouble every citizen. Expectations. Our culture often signals that leaders must know with absolute certainty, and it conveys to them in hundreds of ways, both large and small, that uncertainty is bad. Indeed, leaders are often ridiculed if they don't provide specific promises to deal with every conceivable problem. Consider the pressure executives feel to project next year's earnings to financial analysts. Woe to the company that misses the prediction because of unknown forces. And when the COVID-19 pandemic struck, there were endless debates. What caused it? Did we act quickly enough? When will we be able to return to normal life? What will normal look like? When will the economy fully recover? The answers to these questions were uncertain. They were subject to speculation and opinion. Yet, often leaders were judged by their ability to provide accurate answers to unknowable questions. The models were all wrong. In fact, models are almost always wrong in some small or large way. Yet, if you use multiple models, it will help you keep uncertainties in mind by visualizing various potential outcomes. So what? Our beliefs shape our memories, fuel our actions, and influence our plans. Consider a prosaic belief like, houseplants require watering. If one of your houseplants dies, your first thought might be, I wonder if I watered it enough. That question instinctively emerges from your core belief about how plants live and grow. Likewise, that belief explains why you routinely water your plants and even set up a watering schedule. Of course, your plant growth beliefs are tempered by other beliefs and circumstances. You can drown plants with overwatering. Cacti don't need the same amount of water as your ficus tree, and so on. Likewise, easing up on the uncertainty watering jug makes sense in many circumstances. In general, though, believing that embracing uncertainty accelerates growth shapes a caring leader's approach to learning, planning, coaching, communicating, and a host of other important tasks. We will more thoroughly develop this thought in part two. For now, you can enhance your commitment to the embracing uncertainty accelerates growth belief by contemplating the following questions. 1. Do you accept that there are questions that don't have answers and issues that are unknowable? There is much more uncertainty in the world than ever gets acknowledged. Instead of wasting time and energy fretting over things that can't be known, caring leaders devote time and energy dealing with things they can impact. We believe it is far better to plan and execute on the best available options that maximize the chances for positive outcomes, instead of expending energy by asking questions and requiring answers for things that are unknowable. Situations are rarely one-dimensional. The best outcomes result from approaching problems on multiple fronts, addressing all the issues we know at the time. For example, during the COVID crisis, the CEO of United Airlines, Scott Kirby, abandoned any attempt to predict when the demand for travel would fully rebound. Instead, he formed a bounce-back team to envision slow, medium, and fast recovery scenarios. This insight about uncertainty allowed United to ride out the turbulence until the crisis abated. The unknown can be a source of motivation. Jacques-Yves Cousteau, the famed oceanographer, would never have plunged into the depths of strange waters without a love of the mysterious. Sir Edmund Hillary would never have scaled Everest without a willingness to face the unknown dangers of high-altitude climbing. But it is not only when exploring the heights and depths of our world that people need to make peace with their ignorance. Almost every important intellectual accomplishment starts with a willingness to embrace naivete. David McCullough, the Pulitzer Prize-winning biographer, may have said it most eloquently. I feel that each project I've undertaken has been a huge adventure. A lesson in a world, a subject, a territory I knew nothing about. People will sometimes say to me, well, what's your theme? As I start on the new book, I haven't the faintest idea. That's one of the reasons I'm writing the book. Well, you don't know much about that subject. That's exactly right. I don't know anything about the subject, or very little. And again, that's exactly why I'm writing the book. I think if I knew all about it and I knew exactly what I was going to say, I probably wouldn't want to write the book because there would be no search. There would be no exploration of the country I've never been to. That's the way one should feel. In short, conquering any new geographical or intellectual territory begins by squarely facing our lack of knowledge. 2. Do you transparently communicate about the knowns and unknowns? This includes acknowledging that your current plans for managing uncertainty may not bear fruit. If you don't know, do you say so? If you have a point of view, do you let others know? Are you trying to create the aura of certainty where none exists? When you say, I don't know, others will not necessarily hear I'm stupid or I'm ignorant. Instead, by admitting your uncertainty, you can inhibit hasty decision-making, thus encouraging further inquiry or deliberation. Interestingly, speakers may not even be aware that this conversational ploy stimulates more thoughtful inquiry and solutions to complex challenges. A caring leader with a bit of a more whimsical spirit could even indirectly signal to others the power of uncertainty. By prominently displaying the right artifacts and books in his or her office. An unfinished Leonardo da Vinci painting. An old LP record jacket of Franz Schubert's unfinished Eighth Symphony. Or the enticing book Britannica All New Kids Encyclopedia, What We Know and What We Don't. 3. Do you routinely applaud resiliency? Reminding people of classic comeback stories, for example, the United States after the Great Depression, has a way of framing challenges in terms of resiliency rather than on immediate results. Tales of how obstacles have been overcome build members' personal confidence that they can get through the most demanding situations. Caring leaders can celebrate resiliency with a great deal of confidence because researchers have shown that over 90% of things most people worry about never materialize. You could think of this anxiety as false event appearing real, fear. Resiliency focuses attention on people's hopes rather than fears. 4. Do you spin complex and uncertain issues 360 degrees around by trying to see them from all sides? Solutions to complex problems are rarely one-dimensional. Rather, viewing an issue from many sides ensures better outcomes. For example, in shaping a response to the COVID virus, one organization's leader considered questions such as, what are the physical, emotional, financial, and social implications for our team members? How will the virus affect our suppliers, customers, family members? How can our expertise serve the national interest in innovative ways? How can we provide a sense of purpose and civic duty during this time? In contrast, when employees experience pressure to accept at face value the official rationale for organizational decisions, cynicism spreads virally in the organization. Cynical employees often suspect that decision makers have not clearly thought about the real underlying problems from many different perspectives. Political expediency prevails. How do employees come to this conclusion? Experience. In particular, the experience of not having meaningful opportunities to share in decision-making, or even being informed about what is happening. In short, an organization that devalues contemplation naturally spawns cynicism. 5. Do you trust that, for the most part, people have the organization's best interests in mind? Leaders often have to dig deep into their reservoir of faith in others during uncertain times. Thoughtful leaders will hear conflicting advice from experts and face pushback against their own ideas from others. This can be challenging, and leaders might be skeptical. Yet resilient leaders need the support of their team to robustly respond to the inevitable setbacks and move the organization forward. Plus, leaders will need to rely on other opinion leaders to translate their vision and perspective to people beyond the leader's immediate influence. 6. Does your language convey a sense of tentativeness rather than certainty? Several Harvard University scholars investigated teachers who incorporated into their lectures a tolerance for new ideas and a respect for uncertainty. Students were put in one of two groups. Group 1 was taught a task traditionally, with an emphasis on the rote learning of steps, while Group 2 was taught the same task with a greater emphasis on general principles and flexibility. The results were revealing. Both groups performed equally well on a direct test involving the task. However, Group 2 performed significantly better when it encountered novel or slightly modified tasks. Group 1 had to rely on a memorized routine or a checklist. Even subtle changes in language appear to produce this effect. In a similar experiment, one group was instructed with the words, "This is A," while another group was introduced to the task with the words, "This could be A." Note the tentativeness conveyed to the second group. The results were similar to those in the previous study. Professor of Psychology Ellen Langer summarized her findings. The key to teaching this new way is based on an appreciation of both the conditional or context-dependent nature of the world and the value of uncertainty. Teaching skills and
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.